thank you for coming, first of all. And I don't know why, every few years I kind of get my brain stuck on the Lord's Prayer and just think about it a lot and try to read some things about it. And it's amazing if you think about it. There are probably no words that have ever been written that have been spoken out loud by so many people so many times. You know, in your lifetime, you have probably said the Lord's Prayer, who knows how many times. And you say it at interesting times. I married a couple on Saturday evening, and the first words they said after I announced they were husband and wife were, "Our Father, who art." It was interesting, right? Good way to start a marriage, I suppose. And so I wanted to think about this together. And your handout is itself pretty interesting. You know, we think of the Lord's Prayer as something that it just occurs in church, right? It's time for the Lord's Prayer, and we say it together. But, of course, it's in the Bible. I had someone ask me about that one time. I said, "That's not in the Bible, is it?" Yeah, it's really in the Bible. And it's in the Bible twice, and it's in the Bible in two different forms. It's in the Gospel of Matthew, and it's in the Gospel of Luke. The wording is different, and the context is different. And this is interesting. And by the way, before I get to that, you know, recently, if you go to church here, some of you don't, but you should. Kidding. We've been saying the Apostles' Creed forever, and we changed to another creed, right? And some people, oh, they love it because, like, it's fresh language. And I've gotten a lot of complaints, like, got to keep saying the same creed. And so it's interesting. It asks about the value of things that we say by rote. And sometimes the complaint is you don't think about it. But I'd like to think there's a virtue to things that you say by rote over and over and over to the point that you aren't actually thinking about it again. If you're Roman Catholic, one of the things they do is they pray the rosary. And so you go through these beads and you repeat these prayers over and over and over. And you aren't particularly thinking about them. In fact, with the rosary, you aren't supposed to be thinking about the words of the rosary. The way it works is while you're praying the Our Father or the Glory Be to the Father, you're supposed to be thinking about something else, like the crucifixion of Jesus, the conception of Mary. And so you see what I'm saying? So you're supposed to be contemplating something else in that context. When I think about things that are rote, I love things that are rote. Some of it is, it's just personal. I grew up in a family where, and if you're running into some of my family members, don't repeat this. I grew up in a family where people just didn't say, "I love you." So we're in the kind of family that when somebody dies, and I do funerals for folks like this son, they say, "I'm sure my mother loved me by how she acted or whatever, but these aren't things that are really expressed. I'm married into a family that they always, at the end of any conversation, however brief, say, I love you. I love you." And it got on my nerves for a little while, right? Because I hadn't heard it all that often. I was kind of looking for, oh, I love you. And you can't really do that five times a day, can you? Keep it up. So in our family, we just say, I love you all the time. And it's kind of cool because there's never really any doubt. You say it, you repeat it, it's always there no matter what happens. It's something that you do by rote. So the Lord's Prayer is something we do by rote. If you look at your handout, the two versions of the Lord's Prayer, Matthew, on the one hand, the context in Matthew is really interesting, right? Because when Jesus gets around to the Lord's Prayer, he said all this stuff about, this is amazing to me, "Beware of practicing your piety before men in order to be seen by them, for then you will have no reward from your Father who's heaven." And as you can see, as I've outlined in color for you, there's a lot in here about what is seen and then what your reward is. In our church, we don't suffer from too many overly pious people who show off their spirituality to others. Do you see many of these running around our church? If you do, send them to my office, right? But in many religious situations, there are people that they're known as being pious, and they're praised for that. And Jesus seems to be concerned about that. What do people see you doing? What is the reward that you're after in your spirituality? That's a good question. Continuing in Matthew, down in verse 6, Jesus says, and I love this. He says, "But when you pray," same thing in verse 5, "when you pray," if you look over in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 11, verse 2, Jesus says, "when you pray." So Jesus is assuming that you're praying, right? It's not, oh, hey, remember to pray, but when you pray, and his assumption would be that like all Jews, it was required in those days that you would pray three times a day. There were set times during the day, or there were set prayers during the day, and you prayed at least three times a day. They weren't super brief prayers. They were a little bit longer. So I always wonder about this kind of discipline for us. If we could set a discipline of maybe morning prayer, midday prayer in the middle of what you're doing, evening prayer. If you were Muslim, it'd be even harder, right? Because they have to pray five times a day, and at set times, and with a posture toward a given location. I love the thing, I've told some of you this before, Will Willimon, when he was the chaplain at the Mecca of all learning, Duke University, said he had a Muslim student who came to him one time and just asked, why don't the Christian students ever pray? Because if you think about it, if you hung around Duke University, you would not see any person who might claim to be Methodist. I'm sure at Chapel Hill, they're always stopping and praying, middle of a fraternity party, oh, let us pray. There's this whole business of regular prayers. Jesus assumes you're doing regular prayer. So he says, when you pray, pray like this. And in Matthew, Jesus is worried that you might pray too long. Right? So in verse 7, and in praying, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, but they think they will be heard for their many words. This is interesting. So it's not that God hears many words, or it's not volume, it's not... You know, sometimes we have these... I'm getting way off track already of what I wanted to talk about. Sometimes we have these... what do you call them? Like prayer chains or whatever? Or people start emailing something around, pray for... so-and-so, somebody nobody's ever heard of, and you keep passing it around. And the idea, I guess, is if you've got thousands of people praying, this would matter more than if just two people were praying. But the God of the Bible doesn't seem to, it's not the volume or any of that that matters. It's something that comes out of the heart that matters more when you pray. There's another interesting thing that was suggested. Hang on, let me keep going. In Matthew, after Jesus teaches the Lord's Prayer, and it's important, there in verse 9, you see, Jesus says, pray then like this. Now, the word like, to me, implies you don't have to pray these exact words. It's sort of an example of a way to pray. Pray like this. Not just pray this, but pray like this. And what's striking to me is how little... I put this on Facebook the other day and got a lot of comments, which it's hard to get a lot of comments on Facebook if you're talking about something like prayer. If you put a photo of a puppy dog on Facebook, you get lots of comments and likes. But anyway, so I tried this on Facebook, and what I said is that I am struck, and I still am, at how little the Lord's Prayer has in common with most of the praying that we in fact do. Pretty interesting, isn't it? Because most of our praying, I mean, I'll just ask you, when you pray, what kind of things do we pray for?
Outcomes.
You're looking for an outcome. The Lord's Prayer doesn't seem that interested in an outcome. What kinds of things do we want an outcome for?
Health.
I kept count for a while a few years ago of prayer requests that come to the church. We have like a web thing and people can make prayer requests. And then I get a lot of phone calls and emails, people saying, James, will you pray for so-and-so? Amazing to me, 19 out of 20 prayer requests that I get are health related. And we live in the healthiest country ever in human history on the face of this earth. But that's the one thing that we think to pray for, because we hear, like right now, we have a young mom over at, what do you want to call it, Presbyterian, Novant. Medical Center had a very serious brain tumor they discovered the other day. Everyone wants us to pray for Jennifer. We should pray for Jennifer. This prayer, this Lord's Prayer, isn't praying for much of anything at all. It also doesn't, somebody sent me a cute thing and then I lost it, which I hate. By email, it was a cute little ditty that said the Lord's Prayer doesn't have the word I, me, or mine. Right? So this is interesting. So it poses a challenge to how we pray and what we pray about. Jesus prays the Lord's Prayer, and it's interesting if you look here after verse 13, where we wind up the Lord's Prayer. If you think of it, Matthew is the one that we're familiar with. It's the one that you kind of have memorized that you do in church. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. If you look across to Luke, it's actually different. In Luke, Jesus doesn't say, our Father. He just says, Father, which is interesting. That's how Jesus himself would have prayed to God. And it's one of the things that's most striking about Jesus praying is that in a day when the people, when Jews tended to use very formal, complex, highfalutin language to address God, God is the eternal and almighty, and you know, all these adjectives that we attach to God, Jesus just called God very simply, Father. And the word that he used in Aramaic, which he would have spoken, is Abba. And it's a word that means, it's an intimate term. It's what my son would call me. My son doesn't call me, once in a while he would call me Father. There's a little smart-alecky tone when he does that. Well, you know, when we're doing okay with each other, it's kind of dad or daddy, right? And Abba is that kind of term. Well, Jewish kids today, they speak of their father, and they say, oh, Abba, where's Abba? When is Abba coming home from work? So Jesus calls God this, and that's amazing in and of itself. So Jesus himself would have addressed God as Abba, dad, daddy, father. But when Jesus teaches the disciples to pray, he has them say, our Father. We'll say more about that in a minute. Continuing to compare Matthew and Luke, our Father, and then Luke doesn't have the who art in heaven. It's interesting. Hallowed be thy name. They both have that. Thy kingdom come. And then Matthew adds, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And then Matthew has the forgive us our debts. And Luke has forgive us our sins. And we Methodists have forgive us our trespasses. We'll say more about that in a minute as we have forgiven others. And lead us not into temptation. Matthew only has but deliver us from evil. In the original manuscripts of Matthew and Luke, none of them have, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. That was not in the original copies of the Bible. That began to emerge in the early church, and evidently they were using this prayer in the early Christian worship when they met in people's homes, and they were hiding out in the catacombs and so on. And when they would finish it, they evidently would sing a little hymn that we wish we knew the tune. You know, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. It eventually crept its way in as if it were part of the original prayer. It's fascinating, isn't it? Now, this whole business of there being two versions of the prayer, you know, you might be inclined to ask, like, well, which was the real original? Right? But another way to think about that is that Jesus would have, this must be the case, Jesus must have taught all these things that we know that he taught more than once. Right? Like if Jesus had, let's say the story of the prodigal son, like you hope he told that more than once, right? It's such a good story. He should have told that 25 times in lots of settings to a lot of different people. So surely the Lord's Prayer, at different times people asked him about prayer and he taught it and he would have used different wordings at different times. Continuing with the context, Matthew continues with this business about forgiveness, and when you fast, prayer for him is related to fasting. We don't like that idea much. It's doing without something, fasting. When you fast, do not look dismal like the hypocrites, for they disfigure their faces, so that their fasting may be, there it is again, seen by men. Truly I say to you, they have received their reward. When you go over to Luke, the context is entirely different. It begins with this conversation that Jesus has with a guy who says, you know, what is the great commandment? It's you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And then the rest of Luke chapter 10 explains what it means to love God and to love the neighbor. Jesus begins by what it means to love the neighbor, and he tells that really, really challenging story about the Good Samaritan, right? The guy's beaten up by the side of the road, and the people who should help him don't help him, and it's the Samaritan, the sort of hated stranger who is the one who stops and helps. He proves to be a neighbor to the friend. That's what it means. Love your neighbor is somehow about that kind of thing, not just being a pal to the person that lives next door to you. So that's what it means to love your neighbor. And then Jesus goes to what it means to love God, and you have the story of Mary and Martha, where Jesus comes for dinner, and Martha is doing the thing you do when people come for dinner, right? She's making sure all the dishes are out and all the food is super well prepared, and she's got her Martha Stewart gig going, and she's really entertaining well, but she's stressed by it, right? And she's more stressed by it because she has a sister who, what, is not helping her in the kitchen. She's just sitting at the feet of Jesus, listening to what Jesus has to say. which is a gender issue in those days, because in those days when a rabbi would travel, he would come to someone's home, and the expectation was that the men who had gathered there would sit at the rabbi's feet and learn from him. The women were supposed to do what Martha was doing, which is to stay in the kitchen. So Mary is just really upsetting the apple cart. And Jesus sides with Mary, and it's an example of what it means to love God. You sit at the feet of Jesus, you listen to his words, you're attentive to him, you adore him, you're obsessed with him, whatever all of that is. So then in that context, Luke says that Jesus was praying in a certain place. And this is common in the Gospels. This is always something that's remarkable, is that when they tell the story of Jesus, it's not just he did this, and then he did this, and then he did this, is over and over it says, and Jesus withdrew to a quiet place to pray. Or Jesus went up on a mountain by himself to pray. In this case, Jesus was praying in a certain place. When he ceased, one of his disciples said to him, Lord, teach us to pray. Now, that's important, right? Because the teach us to, well, two things. One, why would they ask Jesus, of all people, teach us to pray? He's an authority on prayer. He's a rabbi. Rabbis would be knowledgeable about these matters and could instruct on them. Why else, though, would you... Who do you know that you would say, tell me about prayer? Thank you very much. Say someone who's not here.
They saw him praying a lot.
We don't know. It doesn't say what their motive was for asking this question. But I tend to think that what they saw was an incredible intimacy with God. And when they saw that, they thought, I want some of that, right? Anybody... Who, name someone you've known, not that you think is a smart teacher or something, but somebody you've known who you thought, I want some of what they have.
Kevin Wright and the joy that would beam out of him.
Just name anybody, where you are.
Eric.
My grandmother.
Grandmothers always come off well in these things. Some are cranky, you never know, but... Yeah. So they say, teach us to pray. And the other thing about that that I think is important is that prayer, and according to the Bible, is something to be learned. It's not something that you just know how to do. I wrote a book on prayer years ago, and one of the early chapters in it says, on the one hand, prayer is kind of whatever is in your mind and your heart. And whatever's in your mind and your heart, God wants it from you. It's like when you're in a close relationship with someone, right? You don't want them to close up and not tell you stuff. You want them to open up, share whatever's on their mind and heart. Sometimes it's not the best thing just to share what's on your mind. Without getting into politics, I guess that would get me into politics, wouldn't it? Somebody said the other day, though, what I like about Donald Trump is that he speaks his mind. But speaking your mind is not... It depends on what's in your mind, but at any rate. But with God, you speak your mind, even the ugliest thoughts. So on the one hand, prayer is kind of anything, and there's not a right or wrong to it. It's like children's coloring. When children color, you don't say, you got outside the lines and the skies really shouldn't be brown. You don't do that. So on the one hand, we pray that way. But on the other hand, prayer is this thing that is to be learned. Otherwise, if we don't learn prayer, then we only pray... What part of the Lord's Prayer would you pray unassisted, if you will? Like on your own, you wouldn't think, oh, I hope God's name is hallowed. Yeah. Right? That's just not an issue that you have. You don't even really pray independent. I don't think you don't pray, thy kingdom come, which is what I'm focusing on between now and Christmas. That's really struck me as a big deal. That doesn't occur to us. The only one that occurs to us is really the tone of, give us this day our daily bread, right? Our praying basically is, on our own, is, Lord, give me We don't even know give us this day our daily bread. We say give me my, or her, I love her, so give her something. So this hope is of learning to pray. And so Jesus, in teaching this prayer, wants us to learn to pray. And then after he tells the story about the person who's hungry and at midnight goes knocking on the door of his friend and his friend won't get up, but he keeps persisting. There's something about prayer that's persistent like that. And then I love the very end of it. He talks about ask and it will be given you, seek and you will find, knock and it will be open to you. And some people love to quote this and say, if you just pray for things, believing, God will give whatever you ask for. And if anyone ever says this to you, just call them a liar. Because this is false. This is false. And you need go no further than Jesus' own praying. When Jesus said in Gethsemane, Father, let this cup pass from me. And he had as much faith as any of us. And God could say, okay, no cross for you. But that's not how that goes. And it's interesting the way this follows up. Jesus says, for everyone who asks, receive. He who seeks, finds. To him who knocks, it will be open. What father among you, if his son asks for a fish, will instead give him a serpent? Or if he asks for an egg, will give him a scorpion? These are ridiculous examples, aren't they? If you then, who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will the Heavenly Father give? Isn't that interesting? The Holy Spirit to those who ask. It's amazing, isn't it? It seems to imply that what you get for your praying is the Holy Spirit. Tim Keller has written this wonderful book about prayer. I quoted it in a sermon a few weeks ago. He said that when Paul talks about or prays in any of his letters in the New Testament or in the book of Acts, Paul never asks for a favor. Paul never asks for circumstances to be changed. The only thing that Paul asks for in his praying is God. Right? Like just more of God. And that seems to be what is promised in all of that. And that takes me back to Matthew. Jesus says, when you pray, if you're seen and people admire you, then that's your reward. But your Heavenly Father has some reward that he wants to give you. The word seems to be God himself. That's really something to ponder. Okay. Let's go through some of these lines in the Lord's Prayer. Jesus begins with the Our Father. And the Father, as I mentioned, is this really intimate term. There's a theologian named Karl Barth who wrote this very insightful chapter in a big long book that he wrote about the Lord's Prayer and this whole business of calling God Father. And one of the things that he said in it is it's a mistake for us to think, okay, I know what a father is, therefore God is like that. Why is that a problem? There are all kinds of fathers, and some are distant, some are cruel, some may be actually very attentive fathers, but maybe their values are values that might actually long-term be destructive to a child. That's something for us to think about in our society. Is that we have all these values that are kind of, it's kind of greed-driven, it's kind of busyness-driven. And so we raise our children to be greedy and busy like we are, and it's not good for them. But they seem to be good fathers because you're, you know, playing soccer with them or whatever. Fathers are all over the ballpark. What Bart says is that if we read the Bible, we learn from God what a father should be, could be, and then that becomes the standard against which we measure earthly fathers. See the reverse of that, which is actually pretty interesting. Then you get the whole business of, I was talking to a friend the other day who asked, if Jesus were around in 2015, would he alter this language, right? Would he just say our father, or when he taught sometimes, would he say our mother, right? Years ago, I did a little exercise with a confirmation class, and I kept doing it until they didn't let me teach confirmation class anymore. Got too old or something. And we would go through and we would talk about the characteristics of God and all these Bible passages that we'd read. And then I would ask the kids, which of your parents most embodies what God is like? And then you had to pick one. Like I forced them to pick one. Almost all of them picked their mother. It's like, what is that? Right? So God, Father, God as Mother. Another thing, I just have a theory on this that it doesn't make any sense. It's just kind of my personal pet theory on it. Is if Jesus had to pick, and he wouldn't have to pick, he's Jesus, he can do what he wants, right? But if Jesus had to pick, am I going to call God Father or Mother? This is a crazy exercise, right? Is I'm glad Jesus picked Father. And the reason for this is not because I am a father, because I don't feel very godlike in my fathering. The way I think about it is, I don't know if this is right. If one parent is more likely, this is going to be so wrong, and you're going to argue with me later, but it's fine. But if one parent is more likely to flake, it's going to be the father. Historically, if you look at all cultures across time, fathers historically are way more likely to wander off, not to be home, not to nurture the children. And there are biological reasons for this and everything else. So it's almost as if I wonder if Jesus anticipated something I hear a lot in counseling from people, which is you have grown-ups, maybe my age, and they really suffer inside because they're missing something like where their father was supposed to be. You know what I'm saying? Like, my father was distant, my father was hard on me, my father was judgmental, whatever. And there's this empty place, and sometimes it's too late to fill it because your father's dead, your father is irreconcilable, I don't know what. Sometimes this happens with mothers as well, so I don't pretend that it's only fathers where this happens. Oh. Jesus uses this in his best stories like the prodigal son. Well, then, so then Jesus, though, in Matthew, as I said, he doesn't just say father, which that's cool, but he says our father. And it's important that he doesn't say my father, right? But he says our father. And when we're diagramming the sentence, right? Like grammar teachers used to make you do. You know, what would the antecedent of the our be? What's the reference of the our? Who are the our? Well, on the one hand, he's telling this to the disciples, so he could be saying that God is our Father. And that's reasonable to do if you're with some small group of Christians. Let's say you're in a disciple group or a companions in Christ group or something like that. Together, you think of God as our Father. But then maybe it extends beyond that. Maybe the our, I feel sure, the our is bigger than that. The our is all of God's people. The our is maybe people who don't believe in God. Maybe the our are people who've been hurt by the church. If Jesus' life is any example, Jesus doesn't seem to be one to, we're going to put up a wall here, and these are the good guys in here, and you are the losers over there. Jesus doesn't seem to do that. Jesus seems always to be, his arms just get wider and wider, and he reaches and he pulls in, you know, prostitutes and tax collectors and Romans, all kinds of people. The only people Jesus seems to have a problem with is who? It's the very smug, super religious people who want to keep others out. Jesus, he has a real problem with them. He says to them, woe you Pharisees, because that's their business. Jesus seems to want to bring people in. So when Jesus says, pray our, it's very inclusive. And to me, there's something cool about that, is that when I pray, the pressure's not all on me just to pray. I talk to people all the time who tell me things like, did a funeral for a woman a few years back, and I visited with her husband, I don't know, 4 months later. He was really sad. It was just brutal. Anyway. And it's interesting what he said. He said, I've come back to believing in God and praying. He said, but for a long time, I couldn't believe. I couldn't pray. And the way he put it was interesting. It's not that he felt guilty about that. What he said was, he said, I've discovered that it's a great comfort that there are others who are praying for me and with me when I can't pray for myself. There are others who are believing even when I am doubting. We're so individualistic in America, it's hard, right? You're kind of on your own. The pressure's really on you. You got to make it happen. Dick, it's up to you. You got to be pious on your own. But Jesus always imagines an hour. You're part of a community. You happen to be an individual within that community, but it's being that part of that broader body that's more important. One of the things we talk about in emotionally healthy spirituality It's a course that we did 2 years ago. And if you haven't done that, we're going to have courses this fall on this. It's one of the best things that we've done. You know, you have to get together with other people at church and spill the beans. And it's kind of cool, especially at a place like Myers Park, because a place like Myers Park, the expectation is, I mean, I think this is just right. Let's name it. Everybody's doing great, right? I mean, everybody, they look so happy and successful, and they have great jobs and beautiful homes, and all the children are going to Stanford and getting PhDs and doing amazing. They've cured cancer by the age of 21. They're amazing. Everyone's amazing. And you don't have to scratch very far below the surface to realize it's hard. People are miserable. They got all kinds of darkness that they deal with. And emotionally healthy spirituality just says, like, let's just be honest with each other. And one of the terms that Peter Scazzaro, the guy that invented this, who came and spoke to us with that crazy Bronx accent, we could kind of understand him. I had him on the phone the other day. I was picking on him. One of the things he talks about is refamilying, which is not a word, but he's created it, so now it is a word, refamilying. You're from a family, and maybe you have a great family, and maybe you don't, or maybe it's a pretty good family, or it's got some dysfunction in it. They've all got some dysfunction in it, don't they? If you don't have dysfunction in your family, report to me after class. I'll clarify this for you. Mine's really crazy. And so what you need is like an alternate family. And so what Scazzaro says is the church ought to be that family. It's a place where you come and you love and you accept things and you can be honest and you don't lose people in your family, right? If your child comes to you and says, I've been dealing drugs, whatever, you don't shoot them. You don't, hopefully, you don't say you're not. That's the cruelest thing, I think. I'm getting off track. The cruelest things I hear related to the conversation around homosexuality is when people say to me, okay, I went to my mom and I said, I'm a lesbian. And she said, you are not my daughter any longer. You know, in the family of God, this is not an option, right? Jesus tells that story of the prodigal son. It explains all we need to know about our father. The son goes away, squanders his living in a foreign land, and the father's always looking for him to come home. And when he comes home, the father doesn't say, I told you, not, you know, for me, throws a party. To the Our Father, I got to keep moving. Our Father who art in heaven, it's interesting, it's like it's God's address, God's in heaven. One of the things that I think is helpful to think about God being in heaven is it implies, how to put it, that God's sort of above us. God is over us. God's not too caught up in the mire of little things that happen down here. Sometimes we domesticate God too much. We make God, you know, God's a Republican, or God's a Democrat, or God's a Duke fan, or yeah, whatever we do. We kind of make God, we shrink God down to size. But Jesus said, our Father who art in heaven, he's above us, it's beyond anything. And I love this, hallowed be thy name. It's, of course, related to the, in the Ten Commandments, thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain, which does not at all mean don't cuss, although cussing's its own bad idea. But it's not in the Ten Commandments, right? Don't take the Lord's name in vain. Of course, in Judaism, what that meant, and some of you know this, if you've been in Bible studies and things. In Judaism, if you go back to the ancient Hebrews, God's name, remember this, God is, Moses comes to the burning bush, and God speaks to him, and Moses asks this interesting question. He says, what is your name? Right? Like, we don't think of God having a name. But in that world, there were a lot of gods. And so what's the name of this God? It's kind of like some people call me preacher, you know. Like, I don't mind. But I'd rather you call me James, right? Because I might just come back to you and say, yes, lawyer, or whatever. Plumber, or whatever. I'm the preacher. I'm a preacher, yes, but I'm the preacher named James. God, the Israel's God, was the God named Yahweh. But for them, that name was so sacred that you never even said it. Like, you wouldn't say it out loud. So even in the Hebrew scriptures, when it would come along, it'd have the Hebrew letters for the name Yahweh, and they would put up in the margin Adonai, which just means Lord. So instead of saying the actual name of God, you just go, Adonai. It was too great to say. That's amazing, isn't it? there ought to be some lesson of that for modern culture where we just use God's name so frivolously, right? Or we, what would it mean in our day to take God's name in vain? And I wonder about things like politicians, right? In America, it evidently is pretty darn important if you want to get elected to public office to say, I believe in God. But it becomes kind of blasphemous, doesn't it? Because you're just attaching God's name to something that may or may not have any substance to it. You're just throwing it around. Then we say, well, it's God's will. We go to war. It's God, whatever's God. I heard somebody the other day, I mean, it was an NRA defender. That's fine, you know, but they were just saying, you know, God, it's in God's dispensation. They were saying, they were attaching God to the agenda of the NRA. So we do this all the time. We attach God to our stuff. And, you know, in Israel, like, you don't take the God's name in vain. You know, Jesus says, hallowed be thy name. If we're going to speak of God, we do it with awe, and we do it with reverence. And this whole business of reverence, that's really, that's elusive in our world, isn't it? Like, even in worship, I think it's increasingly hard to find reverence in worship. And I'll raise my hand for, I mean, our very own church. There's something in reverence. Reverence happens. We don't know when it happens. Reverence is somehow being struck silent before something that is amazing. And you're reverent before it. You're still. You're in awe. It's hard to think of things we would even be reverent. You could say, well, the birth of a baby. But now we're almost not even reverent over that kind of thing, right? Because we're immediately doing like selfies and photos and cute stuff. And there's nothing cute about reverence. You should be reverent before life. Jesus wants a kind of reverence in the presence of God. Hallowed be thy name. And then you have thy kingdom come. And this is the one I'm just really focused on. My emails are going to be about this for a long time. To pray for God's kingdom to come. Jesus said this thing about my kingdom is not of this world. And people tend to like that one, right? Because that means I can do whatever I want in this world because God's kingdom is not of this world. Be very clear, for Jesus, his kingdom is not of this world, but his kingdom is in this world. Jesus talked about a kingdom, and if you read the parables, if you read everything that Jesus said, he's always talking about the coming of the kingdom of God. So what is the kingdom of God? It's not Jesus putting on the crown and sitting on the throne and banishing the Romans, which is what people wanted him to do. The kingdom of God is this elusive thing, and it is when God's will is done. That's why the Lord's Prayer says, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. God's kingdom is when God's will is done. So God's kingdom looks like all of these things that really matter to Jesus, like the hungry are fed, the outcast are included, the smug are exposed. All these things that Jesus talks about. Jesus in, this is so interesting, what does the kingdom of God look like? The Beatitudes. Jesus says what? Blessed are the poor in spirit. So the kingdom of God is like poverty of spirit. Jesus says, blessed are the meek. I mean, in the kingdom of the world, the meek don't have a chance. You don't put that on your resume. I'm very meek. Would you hire me? But in the kingdom of God, you go to the top of the list. We want meekness. We want humility. Blessed are the peacemakers. In the kingdoms of the world, it's blessed are the war makers, or rather, blessed are the war winners in the kingdom of the world. But in the kingdom of God, it's blessed are the peacemakers. Paul talks about the fruit of the Spirit. That must be the will of God, right? If Paul says this is the fruit of the Spirit, it's love. This is what the kingdom of God looks like. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, gentleness, self-control. When Jesus describes the kingdom of God, he describes crazy things. And when we pray, thy kingdom of God, we're asking for this to happen. So Jesus tells the story about a guy who owns a vineyard. This is amazing to me. And he hires some guys, and they work all day. But on into the day, he's just obsessed with putting people to work. So after 3 hours, he finds some guys that aren't working. He brings them into work, and they work. And he goes find some more people. And he keeps doing this all day long. And at the end of the day, he pays everybody the same amount of money. And, of course, the people who've worked all day are furious about this, although it's a perfectly fair wage. I can't explain what all that story is about, except it seems to suggest that in the kingdom of God, God wants everyone to have enough. And if there's anyone who doesn't have enough, that is not the kingdom of God. So we go on and on thinking about what does it mean to say thy kingdom come? And we're asking God for all this stuff that Jesus talked about. And the question we have to ask ourselves is, do I really want God to deliver all those things that Jesus talked about? Because a lot of that would make us pretty uncomfortable. A lot of that would require us to change what we have. A lot of that would require us to have less. I don't know how to get this. Aldous Huxley, of all people, who's not a very pious guy, coined this very clever phrase that I put in my email the other day. It said, thy kingdom come means my kingdom go. And I like that. We've all got our own little kingdoms, and God's kingdom isn't give me more of what is in my kingdom. Or Lord, strength. This is the kind of stuff we pray for, right? Lord, strengthen my kingdom. Lord, add an addition to my kingdom. Lord, re-roof my kingdom. I don't know what we ask for. Put more wine in my kingdom. Whatever. Better soldiers guarding my kingdom. But Aldous Huxley was right. When we say, thy kingdom come, it means my kingdom go. And I love what Emmett Fox wrote. Our work is to bring more and more of God's ideas into concrete manifestation. That is what we are here for. I mean, I love that. God has all these ideas. We read about them in the Bible. And saints have taught us about them. And our job is to make those things happen. So if you want to know why you're here on earth, it's to help make God's kingdom come. Thy will be done. It's really the same thing. But I love this. I was reading, again, Tim Keller's great book on prayer about this. And the whole idea of saying, thy will be done, if you ever say that to anyone, if I say that to Lisa, your will be done. Sometimes she and I do this, right? Like, I'll say, you decide where we go to dinner. And she's like, no, you decide where we're going to. And what do we not want? So like, responsibility if it's a dud, right? Yeah. But ideally, if you say, your will be done, what I'm doing is I'm ceding control. And what Tim Keller said in his book is, if we pay any attention, we should notice how the desire for control ruins us and others. Anyone who you have ever attempted to control in any way in your life, I predict that has not gone well for you, right? It does not go well to control other people. Because why? It's not love. If I love someone, you have absolutely no control. If I say, Julie, I love you, I've lost myself, right? Because she could then say, I don't know. When I first told Lisa that, right? I remember the night well. I've narrated it in sermons before. Yeah, I took my life in my hands and I said, I love you. She could have said, you're nice. You know what I mean? And I would have died on the spot. So you give up control of yourself. When you try to control, it's not love. So there's something about love. So if we love God, we say to God, thy will be done. Thy will be done. It's hard. How do we learn what God's will is? And that takes a lifetime of like Bible study and prayer and everything else. It's not just patching God on top of what I want to do. And then he adds, on earth as it is in heaven. This is an enormously important thing. God's will, obviously, is done in heaven. So then if we ask, what is heaven like? It's hard to know these things. But you can kind of know. Because we figure in heaven there are no tears, there's no suffering, gosh, this isn't hard, is it? What are some things we have on earth that we think are cool that won't be in heaven? Like, there won't be racial tension in heaven, right? There won't be, let me get in trouble. Gated communities. Not to ding somebody, but you know what I'm saying? Like, we're protecting ourselves. We're keeping someone out. There won't be sections in heaven. There will be whatever. Because in heaven, everybody will be one, everybody will be at peace. So if that's how it is in heaven, then we get busy about it now. If no one's hungry in heaven, then we say that will be done on earth as in heaven, then it's incumbent on us to feed people, right? It won't do in the kingdom of God to say, well, I got my food and Danny doesn't have his because he's a lazy bum. If he just said work harder, that just doesn't work in the kingdom of heaven. That's America talk. That's not kingdom of God talk. Martin Luther King, the night before he died, preaching in Memphis, a garbage worker strike. Beautiful words. He said, it's all right to talk about long robes over yonder and all its symbolism, but ultimately people want some suits and dresses and shoes to wear down here. It's all right to talk about streets flowing with milk and honey, but God has commanded us to be concerned about the slums down here and his children who can't eat three square meals a day. It's all right to talk about the New Jerusalem, but one day God's preacher must talk about the New York. The New New York, the New Atlanta, the New Philadelphia, the New Los Angeles, the New Memphis. I wish he'd been here. Said the New Charlotte. Give us this day our daily bread. Again, it's so important. He doesn't say give me my daily bread or give her daily bread, but it's give us. We're in solidarity with all other people. And one of the things that we just have to think about, I mean, one, I said this in my sermon the other week, to say give us our daily bread, on the one hand, implies a humble sense that we have received whatever we need in life from God. And that's a helpful way to look at living. I told my sermon the other week about the saddest woman that I've ever known. I preached on this years ago. I was at the Davidson Church. The woman came out and she put her finger. I was talking about how we're great debtors to so many people and to God for so many things. She put her finger in my face and she said, I don't owe anybody anything. And what a horrible way to live. It's also the saddest lie. Because we are great debtors to so many people who've been kind to us, who've been good to us, who've been patient to us. Poor God has been. So on the one hand, when we say, give us our daily bread, and we say the blessing at a meal, we're grateful to God. But then it becomes extended because it's give us our daily bread. If it's a gift from God, then you get into this mental confusion over, I mean, what kind of God would say, people in the southeastern United States shall have so much food that they can overeat and throw food away and choose among really fantastic delicacies at the restaurant. I'm not dinging that. I love to eat out as much as the next person, right? You get all of this, and that's just all so great, while other people in the world don't have enough. And that is my will. I made the world to be that way, and that is as it should be. This is just total nonsense. You're not talking about the kingdom of God anymore. You're talking about, I don't know, Adam Smith. I don't know who you're talking about. This is something else. So pretty clearly, in Jesus' dispensation, I mean, I've quoted it many times, and I just think it works. There's a Haitian proverb that said, God gives, but God doesn't share. And I think that just says it all. There is enough food on planet Earth for everybody. And the problem is we don't share. We don't spread it around like we could and like we should if we just had the will. I know some of you in this room are really passionate about there not being hungry people. We should all be that way. It should be intolerable to us that anybody is hungry and doesn't have the basic necessities of life. And I would be someone who would want to extend that things like health care and all, but then you get in all kinds of a political maelstrom with people. Give us this day our daily bread. That also, though, for Jesus' hearers would have called up what story out of the Old Testament? The daily bread. The Israelites are in the wilderness and there's no food at all. And Moses prays that God gives them manna from heaven. And the manna is like the greatest teaching food of all time, right? Because it comes down, it's not all that tasty, but they make do. The jokes about manna helper and things, right, to work on it. And so you go out, and it's enough food for the day. It's not too much. Nobody's going to gain weight or, you know, it's enough food, but it's just enough food for the day. But, of course, there are people. There are always people. And these are the people that in America succeed and do really well who say, what if there's no manna tomorrow? And so they scoop up 3 days' worth. And God in his dispensation, it rots, and it's no good the next day. Like, it's cool, right? So every day you have to go out and get just enough manna. And that's a great image because it means every day you're dependent on God. Every day you look to God. Every day you realize your dependence upon God. You're not trying to get too much. Security isn't everything. It's openness to God that is everything. Give us this day our daily bread. It's like it's just enough. You have to keep looking for it. You can't squirrel it away. They're the hardest part of all this, right? Forgive us. It's always fun when I did this at this wedding the other day. We had some Presbyterians and some Methodists and just some other nondescript people who were present for a wedding. Kidding. As is always the case. Of course, when we prayed the Lord's Prayer, I'm in front so we can do our trespasses. And this is actually easier for Presbyterians, right? Because if you say debts, nobody notices. But if I go to a Presbyterian church and forget, they say debts. And I'm still going, it's passes. And they notice, right? And the question is, which one is right? Well, of course, the Methodists are right. I'm kidding. As it turns out, the Greek word ophelamata is properly translated debts. It is what you owe. But it's a particular kind of debt. It's not the kind of money that I owe you, Cliff, because you owe me some money and I owe you a 20, I got to pay you back. It's not that kind of debt. It's the kind of debt that you have when, oh, I don't know, you have royally fouled up your marriage, right? You've lied, you've cheated, you've drunk too much, you've cheated with another woman. You have a debt to your wife. Well, that's you can't just pay that, can you? Right? It's actually what you owe are the trespasses, the sins that you've actually committed. That is the debt. And how do you overcome that? Forgive us. So interesting. Jesus says, forgive us. Again, it's us. We're in this together. Forgiveness is a community thing. It's not just on me. Together, we want to be about forgiveness. Forgive us our trespasses. Again, Tim Keller, in his very fine book on prayer, says this. Repentance is not... This is another thing we don't think about enough. I did a series on forgiveness 3 or 4 years ago. And I asked people just to talk to me about forgiveness in preparing for this. It was amazing. Almost no one was concerned about whether they were forgiven by God. But everybody wanted to talk about forgiveness with other people, right? Like, my sister made me so mad 8 years ago and I just can't forgive her. But those are hard things. But in the Bible, the first thing everybody's concerned about is forgiveness from God. And then secondarily, they worry about forgiveness among other people. Jesus really turns this thing up. So back to Tim Keller. Tim Keller says, repentance, and that's when you're trying to get forgiveness from God. Repentance is not just getting out of trouble, right? Like, I'm in trouble with God, and so forgive me, God. I want to get out of trouble with God. I don't want to be in debt to God. Repentance is not just getting out of trouble, but it is a way of honoring God and a way of aligning our lives with God. Like when I first read that, it is a way of honoring God. Like at first I didn't get that, then I kept thinking about it, and it's actually pretty cool. If I say to God, your way of holiness is right. It's weird in the world. It's hard. Nobody around me is interested in holiness. But it's really right. I want to be... What better way could you honor God, right? You're saying, God, your ideas are wonderful. They're beautiful. They're pure. They're what I want. I don't want to just mimic what everybody else in the world is doing, just be popular with the people around. So it's a way of honoring God. And he says that it's, where did that go? So we have honoring God, and it's also a way of aligning our lives with God. So it's not just getting God's help, but I want my life to be aligned with God. So whatever God's ideas are, I want those to be my ideas. Whatever God's agenda is, I want that to be my agenda. And then Jesus just adds the really hard part, right? Forgive us our trespasses as we... You wish he hadn't added this. He should have just said, forgive us our trespasses. And instead he added, as we forgive those who trespass against us. I mean, you may say those words by rote, but if you ever say them and mean them, that's the most... I don't know how to put it. Like, some part of me thinks that's the most haunting, daunting thing you could ever say. But I don't think Jesus means that... Right, to make you miserable and feel guilty. I think Jesus must intend that to be liberating for you, right? Because I think what Jesus realizes that we forget is as long as I'm in this, my sister wronged me 8 years ago and I just can't forgive her. You know who's getting chewed up by that? And that would be you. Your sister's not getting chewed up by that. You're the one that's getting devoured by that. And I think Jesus is trying to find a way of liberation if we can forgive others. And I want God to forgive me in the same way that I forgive others. That ought to be liberating and hopeful, because what it means is that in the kingdom of God, everything is about mercy. I preached on this a couple years ago, a series on mercy. Mercy is just so rare in our culture. Like it, I don't know, if you work for Bank of America, is there a lot of mercy at Bank of America? You know, we got this threatening note in the mail today. You owe some medical thing, or some confusion over billing. It was just threatening. We're going to garnish your wages. They wanted $3,000 or something. We're at least not reading this like, oh my gosh. That'd be great, right? Like, they come to the business office here. James's wages, that'd be lovely. Yikes. There's no mercy, right? It's like, there's no allowance that it might be confusing, or there's no allowance that maybe I'm, you know what I'm saying? There's no mercy in our world, but the kingdom of God is always about mercy. So if everything is about mercy, then we forgive, we're forgiven. We don't have to be tied up in knots over these things. And sometimes we just misunderstand what forgiveness is. I'll do this. The Greek word that's used in both those gospels, aphiemi, for forgive. If you went to Greece today, I've never tried this, but it would work. If you went to Greece today and you ran into a Greek speaker on the street and he was holding something and you said to him, I want you to aphiemi that pen. See, I'm holding a pen. I want you to forgive. I want you to aphiemi that pen. What the person would do, they just open their hand and just let it go. That's what the root of the word is. So there's something in forgiveness. We make this mistake, right? Is my sister made me so mad 8 years ago. And so to forgive her must mean, oh, we want to go to the Bahamas together and have warm fuzzies and just be happy and giddy. And some of those people you just hear are never going to get there with them because they made you so mad 8 years ago or whatever happened, right? The forgiveness isn't that. I mean, you think of any, if there's a huge need for forgiveness in these horrible situations that we run into. For instance, the marital thing I described a few minutes ago, or the worst thing, are when you have parents who have abused their children in any way, the worst being the sexual way, but in any way, kind of verbal abuse, just the terrible things that parents have sometimes even unwittingly done to hurt their children. And so I talk to grown children all the time, and they do this like, you know, I'm trying to forgive my mother, and I just can't. And we have to talk through, like, what does it mean to forgive her? Is it can't mean, you know, I want to sit on the rocking chair with her every day and talk and be, you might like that at some level, but it just, some relationships that just can't happen. But you can always let something go, right? You can free the other person, you can free yourself. It's hard. I actually think you can't do this on your own. I think it takes the power of God. Jesus talks about it enough in the rest of the Gospels that forgiveness is something we're not able to achieve on our own. I mean, that's why you have the cross of Christ, right? Jesus goes to the cross and he sheds his blood for forgiveness. And I mean, that really goes back to this old, I'm talking too long. I'll be done in a minute. It goes back to this Old Testament idea. And we always think this is so gross. You have all those old hymns, you know, the Baptists sing, and they're still in the Methodist hymnal, that have all the blood lines in them. You know, like, there is a fountain filled with blood. I mean, what a disgusting thought, right? It's all this stuff about blood. But in Old Testament times, what happened is you would offend somebody beyond what you could figure out on your own. Like, if I borrowed $10 from Cliff and I forgot to pay him back, I go pay him $10. We're okay. But when worse things happen, like when the husband has been horrible to his wife. And I've seen this happen. I've told some of you this before. I've seen this in counseling. I've got a couple in front of me, and he's done something horrible, and she's so upset and sad. And he's just saying, just forgive me. And like, she can just go, oh, okay. But you can't do that. It's too hard. It's too deep. So something supernatural. So in the Old Testament, they knew that. So what they would do is they would take an animal that was really precious to them. Like, this is my best bull, and I need this because this is going to be the father of the new bulls to come along that we need for the crop and to make money. But you would take the best bull, what was most precious to you, and you would kill it, and you'd shed that blood on the altar. And they believed that, like, God owned and was vested in the blood, because that's what keeps you alive. Like you're alive right now because there's blood coursing through you. That's like the life of God in you. So in that sacrifice, what they want to do is to release this healing power of God. So they believe that's how you made up in a relationship like that. You couldn't fix yourself. So that's why Jesus dies on the cross, because we can't do this forgiveness thing ourselves, but the power of God is unleashed. So Jesus sort of anticipates this when he says, "Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us." And he says, "Lead us not into temptation." Let me wind this up pretty quickly, because I know you got things to do. Wow, I love talking about this. This is so interesting. Preparing for tonight, this is like the number one question I've gotten from people emailing, like, what does that mean? Because it implies God might lead you into temptation. Do you ask God not to lead you into temptation? James chapter 1, verse 13 says, "The Lord tempts no one." And this is true. The Greek word that's translated temptation in both the story where Jesus has the encounter with the devil in the wilderness, and then here in the Lord's Prayer, it doesn't mean tempt so much as test. And testing is very different from tempting. Jim, if I want to tempt you, what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to get you to mess up. You'd be an easy mark. I mean, I've traveled with Jim, not hard. I'm kidding. So I want to tempt you. I'm trying to get you. If I'm testing you, though, I'm not trying to get you to mess up. I'm trying to make you stronger. I'm trying to put you through something that will make you better, right? It says, "Lead us not into temptation." So there's almost a humility in that. Like, you know, I'm even wary of the testing, because that'll be hard. So this is almost a word for people that are spiritually arrogant. Like, oh, I'd be fine in the hour of testing. I'll never forget. Years ago, I was a young clergyman. We met with this older, wise clergyman who was just wonderful. And somebody we got to talk about, somebody we'd heard about, some clergy guy had had an affair with somebody in his church. And, everyone is appalled. And so, maybe I shouldn't be talking about this. So I said, I mean, I was 26. I said, "I would never, whatever." And the older guy looked at me and he said, "If you think that, you might." Thanks. What he meant is you need to acknowledge, like, I'm just human. I could really stumble. I probably will. I do dumb stuff all day, and we all do. And if you sort of acknowledge your fallibility, then you have a chance, right? Because you know you're weak, you're wary of things, you trust the power of God, you trust others to help you, and so on. You know, so the lead us not into temptation, it's quite lovely, actually, is that the degree to which we're being well led by God is the degree to which you won't find yourself in bad situations. It may be hard. God will lead us into things that are hard to do, but that's different from being something that's bad that will be your undoing. And then deliver us from evil. The Bible talks a lot about evil. We don't like to talk a lot about evil in our world, but there is such a thing as evil. The problems of the world aren't just the sum total of dumb things that people happen to do together. They're kind of larger forces of evil that come into play. Even something as basic as sort of greedy materialism, if you will, right? Like, you think, well, yeah, what is that? It's sort of a force beyond any one decision. The way you know it's a force beyond that is, let's say I preached a really clever sermon on not being materialistic, and you walked out of church saying, "I am not going to be materialistic." Like, you might make it till 1:30. Maybe. It's the air that we breathe, right? So in our world, we kind of have corporate evil. And so, like, whole nations take on a specter of evil. And it's easy to spot it when it's something like Nazi Germany, right? You go, like, oh, that was an evil. So when it gets closer to home, isn't there evil in America? Right? You know, we go, oh, we're the greatest country. There are problems, and they're big problems. It's not just that 42 people made dumb decisions. Like, there's something in the air. There's something in the whole culture. So the Lord deliver us from evil. It's more than just kind of me making certain decisions. There are larger forces at play. And then in that part that didn't make it into the Bible, but that we say, Sunday by Sunday, for thine is the kingdom. Because not mine is the kingdom. Thine is the kingdom. And the power Anytime we talk about power, it's just so important to remember the kind of thing that Jesus said about power. I mean, I love this. In Mark chapter 10, Jesus says, "You know that those who are supposed to rule over the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great men exercise authority over them." This is power in the world. You have authority over another people, another person. You have power. "But it shall not be so among you. Whoever would be great among you must be your servant. Whoever would be first among you must be slave of all." And in Philippians 2, Paul says, thine is the power. "Have this mind among you, which is yours in Christ Jesus." This is like the ideas of Jesus. "Who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking the form of a servant. He humbled himself, was obedient unto death." That's the power in the kingdom of God that we pray for. It's God's. And it's that kind of power that washes the feet of the disciple, that gives up his life on the cross. "Thine is the power, thine is the glory." There's so much glory in the world trying to get glory. There's a kind of glory that's just reflecting the glory of God forever and ever. Amen. I went way on longer than I meant to. I didn't mean to talk past 8 o'clock. So that's kind of my spiel on this. Let me ask if you have questions or thoughts to share with the group while we're together. Let's just have a couple minutes of this. Anything that strikes you or that you wonder about or that's interesting? Yes? I bet that comes out in choral. There's one word in the original, forever, right? So if we're adding the forever and ever, who knows? I'll have to study this now. You've got my curiosity up. But I bet that kind of thing emerges because it's set to music, and you know when you're singing it's forever and ever, you know, like to throw those things in. I don't know. There's just one word in the original. That's why I would never play handbells. Like, I know I'd be the one to never. Yeah, there's one word in the original. If you think about it, I mean, it's not a bad expansion. I mean, forever is obviously forever. That's an important word to think about, actually, is we tend to hollow out time. And we're so, what did I say in the sermon the other week? I read this from somebody that said, what was the quotation? That stress is an inappropriate understanding of time. Like, I love that. You have to think about it. Stress is an inappropriate understanding of time. If you're stressed, it's time-related always. It's never not time-related. It's time-related. I got to figure this out by tonight. Or, oh my gosh, I'm turning 60 this year. Yeah, whatever it is that stresses us. It's always time-related. It's because we don't understand time as a gift. We view time as an enemy. So we're thinking about God. The context of time is always forever.
Never.
Because after forever, there's even more. I don't know. That's a great thing. What else? What else? Yes.
Is there a certain reason why you say forever and ever? Like, is there, like...
Y'all got me confused now. What do we even say on Sunday morning? Do we say forever and ever, or do we just say forever? Where's the kingdom forever? Oh, man, I don't know. It's all, in all of it, it's so interesting. Jesus would have spoken in a language that's almost like Hebrew, called Aramaic. And we don't know what he said anymore. Some people have tried to guess what the Aramaic would have been, but we don't know. So what we have is, so he prayed, and the people that first heard it remembered it in Aramaic, and they told it to other people, and they told it to other people. And then they told it to people who spoke Greek. They either understood it or somebody translated it into Greek for them. And then the guys who wrote the Gospels, Matthew and Luke, wrote in Greek, which is a very different language from Aramaic. So already, even in the original Greek, it's a translation that is not exact. That's so interesting, isn't it? Like, within 30 years of Jesus' death, It's a translation already. And then that's been 2,000 years ago. We try to translate it fresh today into English, which is a very different language from Greek or Aramaic. So should it be forever and ever or forever? It's a toss-up. We probably ought to agree on that in church, though. Yes.
Is there anything, in your opinion, about the posturing of prayer, whether you do it hands clasped or this way or eyes shut or on your knees?
The posture of prayer. I'm writing a book right now on prayer and worship. I'm almost done. And a section I was working on the other day had to do with that. So I know all there is to know. So the posture is interesting. In Bible times, people largely would have prayed standing. And if they did anything with their hands, they would have lifted them up. This is like good news to like Pentecostals, right? That's the old joke, by the way, about the Pentecostal group that's on the way to the Holy Land. This is such a dumb joke. Why did I start this? They're on the way to the Holy Land, and this is olden days. The stewardess comes out, and she says, those who would like coffee, lower one of your hands. Never mind. But the other day, I was trying to write on the virtue of kneeling and closing your eyes. Like, why do you close your eyes in prayer? Because that was like a bad thing. Like when I was a kid, I think we were in a religious family. So I'd be with my grandparents, and when we'd pray, sometimes like my eyes would be open, and they'd catch me. Although I thought, your eyes were. How did you know? And I guess the point of closing your eyes, we tend to think, is to shut out distractions or whatever. Anyway, that would be something to praying with your eyes open. You know, at least when they're up in the mountains, and you see the beauty of the world. Anyway. But I was trying to think about the virtue of kneeling and how it all started gets really complicated. But what I thought about is that if you are kneeling and your head is bowed and your eyes are closed and your hands are whatever, folded or like, doesn't matter, like this, you could not be in a more defenseless position, right? You can't see anybody coming. You couldn't get up and run. Especially at my age, take you a minute. I'm like, ugh, right? You can't get up and run very quickly. Your hands are folded. They're not, if you're going to defend yourself, you have your hand, you're like this or something, right? But your hands are folded like this. So it's sort of a posture that embodies, like, I'm not defending myself here. I'm humble. I'm vulnerable. The humility of it. There's this prayer in one of the books that almost made it into the Bible that didn't, that's in the Apocrypha. It has a lovely prayer that says, Lord, imprint upon our hearts the posture of our bodies. So it's imagining kneeling in prayer, but don't let that be just something that I do, but let that be what is imprinted. I mean, we were thinking, who are people whose prayer life you'd want in on? You know, I thought of this guy who's a good friend of mine that I talked to last night, and he is just so... his posture is almost humbled. He's not somebody to rear his head back. You know, he's just always humble. When he's ever in front of you, it's almost a bow, like you'd expect from somebody in the Middle East or something. You know, he's just humble. It's lovely. You can see it in his body. It's palpable. He doesn't have to say, I am humble, right? I'm the master of humility. So there's something about that posture. And to think about that, you know, a lot of people that teach prayer say two things that don't agree with each other. One is, if you want to work on your prayer life, you need to find some place that is very comfortable. So you're not like, oh, my back hurts or whatever, right? The problem with that for me is that you doze off. You're too comfortable. Mm-hmm. There have been other traditions that say you make yourself as uncomfortable as possible. So you pray in a stone cell. St. Francis of Assisi slept outside on the stone. He wanted to be as uncomfortable as possible. This is so un-American, because we're all about comfort. Francis wanted to be as uncomfortable as he could be. Why? Because that would remind him of the discomforts Jesus underwent. He wanted to be uncomfortable so that he wouldn't get kind of, overly laid back and taking things for granted. I did this thing in Rome years ago where they have, always have funny things in Rome. They have this set of steps, and they're supposed to be the steps that led up to where Pontius Pilate tried Jesus. Now, why they're in Rome, it's a puzzle. But they're in Rome. And the tradition is you get on these steps, and they're made of stone. But now they've covered them in wood because the stone's getting worn out. And you pray on each step on your knees to the top. It is a long flight of stairs. It's 40 or 50 stairs, so I thought. I'd kind of made a vow to myself when I was young, I would do this. So I was there, and I thought, I'm going to do it. So I get there, and I start on the first step, and the people in front of me are just praying so long. Move on. I'm on my knees here. You know, so it just took forever, and I don't know. You could say, well, that's a stupid thing. And my knees hurt for 3 weeks after that. It was cool. I mean, I know this thing. You know what I'm saying? At least now, the last couple of days, we're in the mountains, and we did, it's like the free vacation. We went hiking. It doesn't cost any money. It's perfect. And we just walked way longer, and the hikes we took were more arduous than we anticipated. So the first day, we thought we had a two-hour level hike, and it was 5 hours, and it was up and down hills, and we had to take off our shoes and wade across these streams. It was hard, terrible. I was exhausted. The next day, she wants to do it again. I wanted to goof off. So we did it again, and that hike similarly was way harder than the day before. And so today, I mean, I am just hurting. You can tell that. And it's good. You know what I'm saying? Like, we never, I thought about this when I was on sabbatical. When I went off on sabbatical 2 years ago, I was gone for 3 months. Nobody noticed. And it was good. And when I was getting ready to go, people said, I hope you rest. Like, what is that? But the assumption is, like, you need, not just me, everybody, you need to, and we're tired. We are tired. A lot of times I'll ask people in counseling, tell me the one emotion that you feel most profoundly right now. Very often they'll say, I'm just so exhausted. You get exhausted because you're out of sync with what you're supposed to be about. Because if you ever know when you're in sync with what you're supposed to be about, you don't find yourself getting tired very easily. You're energized by it, and you're really rocking, and you're going doing it. So when I was on sabbatical, I didn't rest. I had a really daunting schedule. And when I look back on it later, I was trying to blog about it while I was gone. And the best days were the hardest, most miserable days. So there was this one day, my son and I took a hike, and it was an arduous hike to begin with. I wasn't sure that we could do it. So then we started out, and the wind starts whistling, and pretty soon it's sleeting on us. Then it's hailing on us, we've fallen down, we've gotten soaked, and we're just, God, I didn't think we were going to get off this mountain. I mean, I really had moments that I thought, people die out here, right? Because there had been a sign, it's funny, there's a sign my son posed by it before we took off, and it says, danger of death, and he's like, yeah. And we're out there, and I thought, people die, that's why they put the sign there. Anyway, so we made it out, and later we said, that was the coolest day. So I'm like, what is that? I talked to somebody the other day who's a sleep specialist. If you have trouble sleeping, there are all kinds of things that are interesting that help you with your sleep. And one is, if every day you do something that is really hard for you to do, you will sleep better that night. Isn't that interesting? So our whole world, our whole culture is tailored around making things easy for ourselves. Right? You can pick up, you don't have to cook a meal anymore. They got it ready for you at the Harris Teeter. You don't have to go get it at the Harris Teeter. They'll deliver it to your home. Right? They probably will feed you one day. So everything is geared to be as easy as possible for us. And so then I thought about this. Is if you did stuff that was hard, this had to be like when you lived on the frontier in America in 1811 or something. That had to be really hard, right? That had to be every day was hard. The people Jesus talked to, every day of their lives was hard. If you did something every day that was really hard, then when you had to do something that was hard, you'd be used to it. You know what I mean? And you'd be able to do a hard thing because you always do hard things. But we never do hard things, and then when we have to do a hard thing, we're no good at it, and it about kills us, right? So there's something in this praying business about making it hard. Like, pray, teach us to pray. It's hard. It's hard to say, thy kingdom come and my kingdom go. It's hard to say, give us our bread. I don't like my bread. I want my people to have my bread. I want God to help me with my will. But instead, it's thy will be done. But then it's not really hard. Because like my hikes the last couple of days, I mean, they were hard, and I'm sore today, but if you asked me, did we have a good couple of days? Yeah, we really did. It was great. Because it was hard. You know what I'm saying? If we'd sat at a resort somewhere in a jacuzzi, I don't know. I need the jacuzzi time. I'm kidding. I'm rambling there, but anyhow. I'll take one more question if we want to do that. Anybody? I've talked way too long. Thanks for your patience. Yes?
Just your comments on of all the prayers that we've taught, the types of posturing for prayer, I've always been kind of taken with the kind of conversational prayer that you see in Fiddler on the Roof. And that's really conversational. Would you consider that prayer?
You know, everybody has to find their own way to pray, I think. Jesus says pray like this. So it's not just pray this, but it's pray like this. So I want that to dominate the content of my prayer increasingly as I get older. I'm a very short attention span person. And, so for me, I find that closing my eyes and talking to God, pretty soon I'm thinking about, I don't know, what I got to do next. I'm just I'm no good at that. So I find that for me, talking out loud works way better than talking silently with my eyes closed. I can't keep it up silently with my eyes closed. So if I talk out loud, it goes because I do it in the car, you know, I close off a room in the house. Out loud works better. I've talked to people who, worked with a woman years ago, it's pretty interesting. She'd had a lot of difficulties in her life. She would try to come by to talk, and we would sit down, and she would just cry and leave. And she kept doing this. And I could tell she was dying inside. So finally I just said, she was emailing me like, sorry that happened. She was talking in the email saying, sorry I couldn't stay and talk, right? So I just said, why don't you email me? What's going on? Well, she wrote this long. People say email isn't good. Oh, my God. She poured out eloquently all this stuff. And I answered. And we just kept doing that. That was the way she could communicate. So for some people, probably writing or something is going to be, you know, the mode that makes sense. Time of day, you know, I always hate, like, the great spiritual heroes are morning people. You always hear John Wesley prayed from 5 to 7 in the morning. Ain't happening with me. I'm a night person, so I could pray at midnight. That actually works for me. Everything's quiet then. I'm awake. So you have to kind of find your own, you know, way and voice and thing that works for you. There's no one way. But then again, to stretch toward, against the content, that's always the hard part where you have to stretch yourself, I think. You get on your knees all day, that's a good thing. But the harder part is, you know, what's going to be painful for me in my life to embrace that is from God. And if you go to a therapist, right, you never go in, free to you do this for a living, right? Do people come in and they're greatly troubled and you tell them, oh, there are three easy steps and they'll be fun. Never, right? They have to talk about things and it's excruciating and what they have to work on is extremely difficult. There's healing if they will do the work, but if they won't do the work, they don't get the healing. So, yes. All right. We made it 8:30. I didn't mean to keep you all past 8. I apologize. It's been fun. Thank you so much for coming and thinking on these things. Feel free later, shoot me an email or thoughts, a question you get to ask or some comments you have. I keep trying to learn on these things, and you helped me do that. So thank you for coming.